Fort Worth, Cowtown, USA. It's The Dean Show with your host, Dean Gosden. I'm John Fallon, surrounded by laugh tracks left over from the Merv Griffin Show, inviting you to join Dean and his guests, Jeff Fenter and Mia Kane. And now, with his final monologue of the first season, here's Dino.
Boy, final monologue from the first season, hopefully.
Yeah, sure.
No, we'll be back.
Of course.
You know, we're just getting started. We're just getting warmed up for all you 25 people that are back watching. And for all you 3,000 or 4,000 that haven't come back, well, you know what you're missing. So, but anyway, yeah, well, this is our last show.
Until the fall.
Yeah,
for a couple of
because you're leaving town, and I'm going to just go take a long walk. I think a very long walk. But this is our last show, and I guess just like anything else, you know, you just got to get traction going. It'll keep coming back and keep coming back and keep coming back. Persistence, pleasant persistence, is the key to success, I think. So we'll keep coming back, and besides, we can't get canceled. So
that's right.
No big deal. So, but anyway, in the news, I don't know if anybody saw this, but I guess some of the car manufacturers are having trouble with. I guess they're building cars that are really complicated these days. I guess you know what it takes. You buy a new car, you got to sit in class for 10 hours or so to learn how to use it. Huh. And I guess for older people, seasoned citizens, I guess they're having a hard time selling them new cars because they can't understand everything. So they're trying to build cars that are user friendly for this age group. I guess they're putting bigger numbers on the radio things, and they're putting they're putting up like cross traffic alerts if there's somebody's passing you, or backup cameras, and so you don't back over the grandkids, I guess. I don't know. I guess they did a survey of a bunch of senior citizens and said what would you like in a car. And I think an overwhelming majority of them said, give me a 64 Buick Electra any day and I'll be fine. So. And you know what the number one car was? I mean, they did check the cars, and they found out which one was the best one for senior citizens. You know what it was?
Well, they stopped building the Grand Marquis, so I guess that's up on the list. What's left? I don't know.
It was the Impala.
Ah.
Yeah, the Impala. Course. And I guess that's about accurate because, you know, my grandmother drove an Impala. And a Buick Electra. So Chevy Impala, I guess, is going to be the old car of the future, the old person car of the future. So anyway, moving on. I guess if you're in Fort Worth, you saw the Johnson family mortuary mess up. That's a better word. I guess they got evicted from their deal and left some merchandise behind, if you will. And I guess they talked to they went over and interviewed one of the Johnson family people, and they said that we did that, but we have no idea anything about Casey Kasem. So anyway, in case you didn't know, Casey Kasem's body has disappeared, and that's, you know, I think that's probably, there's probably something to that. There's probably going to be like 100 years, kind of like the Amelia Earhart thing. And they're going to eventually, you know, they think they found Amelia Earhart, speaking of lost people. They think they found her plane on that deserted island.
Again, huh?
Yeah. Well, no, it's the same one, but they found a picture. I guess she had a window that had been busted out. Huh. And they found a plate on that island that matches the plate that was covered over that window of her airplane.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Okay. Back in those days, because I guess that window was originally for someone to look to navigate by the stars or something, and I guess they somehow got broke, so they plastered the same. And that the rivets weren't the same rivets they'd used on the airplane when it was originally built.
Yeah.
And so they're saying that she didn't just crash into the ocean, but she lived the rest of her life on this island.
Yeah.
And
I don't know.
And so anyway, so with that, you know, that Gilligan's Island was born. I don't know. I just read that. I thought that was interesting. So
hard to believe.
Yeah. Well, you know, if you're looking at this monologue and you're saying to yourself, it sounds like he just wrote that. Well, it's because I did. So anyway, so I guess that's the end of this deal. We got to get moving along here. So come back in a few minutes. We got Jeff Fenter and Mia Crane, Mia Kane. With us tonight. So anyway, thanks for coming, and we'll be back in a little bit.
All right. Thanks for coming back. Wow, last show. Well, until the fall.
Yeah,
we're going to come back in the fall.
Taking a brief hiatus there.
Right.
End of summer hiatus.
Right. Yeah. You're gonna go back to Jersey and.
I am. Yes. I'm gonna go jump in the ocean and wash the embalming fluid off of me. That's what I look forward to at the end of every summer. So yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, when you go back, I mean, how close to the ocean are you?
Oh, well, the family has a house pretty close to
really?
The ocean.
Yeah, I mean, do you fish? I saw a video one time.
I'm an opportunistic fisherman. When the fish are biting and everybody's out there, that's when I run and get the reel.
But I see.
I don't try to initiate anything. I just join in.
So you don't have, like, the vest or the hooks and the hat and all that?
No, I don't. I don't. Yeah.
I've got a limited knowledge of fishing in the ocean.
Yeah.
Because I've never, I mean, when I was a kid, we had family that lived in California. We went out there and I tried to, I don't know, surf fish or something.
Okay.
And it seemed hopeless to me. And then we went out on a boat and I managed to be the only guy on the boat, kid, that caught a fish I couldn't keep. They showed up with like pliers and and poles and stuff like that. So now we got to throw this one back. And because it was some kind of stinging fish.
Oh.
So most of my fishing experience has been like in lakes and and streams and stuff like that.
Sure.
So how much success? I mean, do you get success? I mean, do you
catch fish? There are runs. You know, you watch the birds. Right. And the birds will start diving in there to go after the smaller fish. And then you know that the bigger fish are going to come in after the smaller fish.
Really?
And that's when it's a good time to
And what do you catch? I mean, what do you catch from the shore is what
blues.
You're talking about.
You can get pretty good bluefish. I've seen people catch small sharks.
Really?
Stingrays.
No,
different kinds of rays.
Right.
Catch a lot of stuff on the Jersey Shore. It's remarkable.
I've heard of the whitefish.
Yeah. Coney Island whitefish. Coney Island whitefish. Yeah, okay, right.
That's another day and another story, I think. But anyway. So do you eat these fish? Or they?
Yeah,
they...
yeah, I have eaten them in the past.
Really?
The blues are very good, yeah.
Really? No kidding. Wow. I've never caught... Well, let me rephrase that. When I lived in California, I did get a chance to go out on a boat. We went tuna fishing and I caught two yellowtail, I guess is what they were.
Mm, yeah.
And it was the whole boat thing was just so strange because you see one guy over here go like that, and he'd yank, and then right behind him on the other side of the boat, so he'd go down like that, because he was like hooked underneath, and they'd sit there and reel each other in for 20 minutes until one of the deckhands came by and said, I think you got the guy, and blah, blah, blah.
Wow.
But they also had, what they had with these guys, and this is like in the 80s, these guys would come by, and for 50 cents, they would fillet your deal for you.
Yeah.
And so before I caught some fish, there's some other people caught some fish, and I watched them do that.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, why should I burn two quarters?
Oh, man. Yeah, right.
And so I took these two friggin' fish that were this big home and managed to turn them into goop.
Yeah.
I ended up throwing away. I had nothing to eat by the time I was through filleting my fish.
That is an art.
Yeah,
yes.
I guess
yeah,
so.
Right.
But they did it so fast. They just had these knives.
Right.
And there you go. And so I figured I could do it, too, but I couldn't. But, we used to catch some perch and some catfish and stuff around here that we'd fry up and eat with stuff. But I've never been a fisherman. I never have. I got friends that are, you know, big fishermen that have boats and things like that, but I never got into it that much.
I just get bored too easily.
Yeah. Well, I think that's you know,
yeah,
part of my deal too is I just you sit there, and then I think the most exciting kind of fishing for me was the kind where you do it with a cork. And you watch the cork, and the cork kind of goes,
bobber, right?
Yeah,
here.
It's kind of like that scene in Jaws where the little girl goes like that. And you're like, hey, yeah. And then you watch it; it moves a little bit, and then it becomes like a little game or something like that. But, yeah, I grew up with cane poles and stuff like that. So, so you're gonna go back to New Jersey and hang out. And do you ever get up to New York when you get back?
Oh yeah. Take a train to New York, hour and a half.
Really?
Less actually.
Really?
More like an hour.
You're from, it's a president. Lincoln? Madison? What?
Madison. Right.
Yeah, exactly. Madison, yeah. New Jersey, yeah. Right. Yeah, the only thing I've got, my New Jersey experience is Summit.
Okay.
I went to a wedding there one time.
Sure.
And,
it's right down the road.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yep. I would remember where it was to save my life. And then and then I took a picture of the Hoboken sign one time.
I think
coming back from Summit into, I had friends that lived out in Long Island. And we
took the train from Hoboken or something?
Well, we drove out to
Summit?
Yeah, out to Summit for the wedding, and then we drove back to Long Island. We went through Manhattan.
I see.
Around, maybe we went south on the Jersey Turnpike and picked up the over to Staten Island and took the Nanos.
Yeah, probably north.
The Glanos Bridge or whatever across to...
Yeah, a lot of those.
Yeah,
yeah, sure.
To the southern Long Island Expressway.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That was kind of fun. It was an interesting place, New York City. It just, it really is. I like to go there. I think it was more fun back in the 80s before Giuliani kind of cleaned it all up.
More dangerous. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
It was more dangerous, but it was more interesting. I was... I remember the first time I was ever there. I was in like Times Square, and I was walking south on Broadway, and I got to about 38th Street, and I looked down right off, and I could see like one of the little lights flashing in a cop car.
Uh-huh.
And you know, the only thing, I mean, you know, it was like the set of Beretta. I mean, I just looked and I thought I'm going to walk down there and see what's going on, and I got about 15 yards off of Broadway,
yeah,
and it got just really weird. I mean, it was just weirder than I'd ever seen in my life, and I didn't go any further. I turned around and went back to Broadway, and there were people walking around doing things.
Yeah, yeah. No, Times Square, before Giuliani, it was just open-air prostitution and drugs.
There was all those things.
The Wild West. Yeah.
It was an interesting place. Yeah, the last time I was there, he may have still been mayor. Last time I was there, Times Square was like Disneyland.
Very safe, touristy. Every major store has a outlet there. Yeah,
It was pretty nice. Well, I'm not gonna do that. I'm gonna stay around here and
okay.
And I don't know if I can get away with it. I may sneak off to the beer store and get me a couple of 30 packs and rethink this whole mess. Actually, this hasn't been that bad of a deal. I mean, we've accomplished.
Pleasantly surprised, my standards were kind of low to begin with.
We've accomplished a little bit of some. We get four shows up, so and almost, I mean, averaged about once a week. So
that's right.
Yeah, so that's not too bad in the independent world, I don't think so. But anyway, so our last show, so we got Jeff Fenter.
Yes.
And hopefully Mia Crane.
Kane.
Mia Kane.
Uh-huh.
She's a body...
she's a fitness competitor. Yes.
Right, okay.
Local fitness competitor.
Great, and hopefully she'll be here and to entertain us. And we're also going to give away...
Oh, the day has finally come.
The Dean Show Cup. For all you people who shared... And when we know who you are, you're in a drawing, and I guess we'll let Jeff or Mia at the end of the show draw that out and draw out the name, and we'll send you that cup if we can re-find you.
Anyway. If you still want it.
Yeah, if you still want it, and it's not bad, you know. I mean, Julie came up with the Oscar deal in 2014. That's the year we hatched this abomination.
It's good.
So anyway.
Lead free, I imagine.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah,
yeah, it's great.
It's lead free and
looks good. Coffee, very solid looking. Yeah.
Coffee free and
okay.
Anyway, so we're gonna do that, and so this is the end of our little deal right here. This is the last show for this year, and we'll be back in a few minutes with Jeff and see what he's up to and what he's got going. And in the meantime, thanks for coming. Hey, thanks for coming back. My first guest here on our last show is a local actor here in Dallas-Fort Worth. He's been in a whole bunch of films. Currently, he's filming Wrong Side of Heaven, and I think there was something else he was currently filming in, but we'll check into that in a minute. Please welcome Jeff Fenter.
How are you doing?
Good. Have yourself.
Good.
So how are the kids? I see you post a lot of things about your kids.
The kids are great. I started late in life on the marriage and the kids thing. So my oldest is 13. This is my stepdaughter,
right.
Sydney. My middle child is 5, which is Easton. And my youngest is 2.5, which is Quinley.
But you call her Q.
I call her Q a lot, or Quinn. So. Well, she's a whole lot easier. That's the reason I'd gone with the name Quinley, because I wanted something that was kind of short but kind of playful and stuff. Right. So we kind of went with Q.
Right. So are you going to push him towards acting? Or?
I tried to my 13-year-old, and she was in it for a little bit. And right. She's kind of gotten more into music and choir stuff in downtown right. Dallas. My middle child has got into it. He's gotten a couple of things so far. We did a Christmas commercial for I can't remember what it was. It was like a loan type pay commercial
right.
A couple of years ago for Christmas. And I was dressed up as an elf. He was the kid sitting on Santa Claus's lap, and I have to go up and try to pull him off. And he's screaming, "Hey, no, stop it!" And doing all that. So
yeah, well,
he's a comedian.
The reason I ask is because you got started at a young age.
Correct. Yeah. I started doing theater. Well, actually, the funny story of how I got started. My sister did a version of P.T. Barnum at Garland Civic Theater back when she was about 8, 9 years old. I went to see the show, sitting in the audience, and I had no clue what was going to happen. First time I'd ever seen a live stage performance. Had no idea what she was doing or anything. She comes walking out with about, I don't know, 15, 20, maybe little bitty elephants. And basically that's all she did. That's all she does. Take it up, go around the stage as the elephant. They were following each other in a line, and they walked off the other side of stage. And I remember sitting there going, I want to do that. That looks pretty cool. So, I don't know, shortly after that, I auditioned for a show called, I was 11 or 12. It was called The Great Cross Country Race. Yes. Yeah. I just turned the big 4-3.
Oh!
It was called Great Cross Country Race, about the tortoise and the hare.
Yeah.
And auditioned, thought I did great, was ready to go. I was ready for the director to call me and give me a role. Didn't get cast. And I'm like, told my mom, like, this is stupid. I'm never doing this again. Why did I do this?
I say that after every audition.
And so I was like, this is stupid. I'm not doing this anymore. I'm ready to move on. Baseball, soccer was kind of a big thing back then for me. So I was hoping at some point to maybe grow up and be a baseball player.
Yeah.
And I don't know, maybe a week or two after they'd started rehearsal, director calls, talks to my mom, and basically tells my mom one of the boys in the cast had broken his arm, had to quit. Would Jeff be interested in coming on?
Really?
So that's how I got my start. So till this day, I still don't know who the boy was that broke his
right.
arm that actually got me in there. Because to be honest, if I hadn't gotten that call, I'm not sure if I'd have ever been doing this.
Probably sitting in a theater someplace.
I'd be sitting watching. I could have been that guy.
That's funny. And so did you continue acting after that? I mean, was that a one-time deal and you took it?
No, and I tell people that's my one and only stage kiss. As well. So I'm 11, 12 years old. I've my one and only stage. Because basically what was going on, the director, how she had it set up was the animals did all the talking, the English, where you can understand
right.
what they were saying. And all the humans were doing sort of like gibberish, pig Latin type stuff where you didn't know what they were saying. So, but me and the girl at the time, they're supposed to be boyfriend, sweetheart type thing that we'd gone into the park and sat down and we're on a little blankie and stuff. And we're kind of gibbering, jabbering, and we have a kiss. That's my only stage kiss to this time. So after that, I started doing theater for years. I didn't really think about anything.
I saw that. You did a lot of stuff over Garland.
Garland Civic Theater. I've done some stuff. Gosh, it's been so long. Garland Summer Musicals. I toured nationally with Dallas Children's Theater for 3 years, 97 to 2000. So I
and you have, I mean, I noticed that, I mean, you do a lot of that theater. I mean, you tap dance, don't you?
I tap dance. I did ballet. I did ballet. Yeah. I did ballet. People freak out now looking at me that ballet for years. Hey, but
I did too.
You do? Yeah. I told you that's the way to get the women. That's how you get the girls.
The problem was I was picking up kids that were like 14, 13 years old.
But the ballet thing, I tell people, I didn't think much about it at the time. I'm like, okay, I'll do ballet. But I started working with Garland Ballet Association, and I was the only guy in the company, and I wasn't great. I was no Baryshnikov by any means, but I got a chance to dance with all the girls, and of course, no other guys there, no competition, and it's like, well, hello, I'm not going to stop this.
I took ballet out in California, or got into it out there. Actually, I had a friend in college that was at the Tech Ballet School, and she asked me to just, like you said, they're always short of men, and they had some big production going on, and she came and said, look, she was in my theater class, she came and said, would you mind stepping up to the plate here and being a guy? You won't have to learn much. Well, anyway, I kind of got that whole vibe about the girls too, and so I kind of decided I liked it. So when I moved to California, I got involved with Riverside Civic Ballet or something, and they gave up. There was a class as well as production, and they let us do it for free because we were guys, because they couldn't get any guys.
Yeah.
It was hard to get guys.
You know, I tell people too, it was the lady that was my ballet teacher was, her name was Paula Moreland, and she was tough, but I learned about respect, I learned about discipline, I mean, I learned about everything that I have now, I feel like, when I go on a set that you're supposed to have on a set.
Right.
So, I mean, besides my parents, I mean, a lot of it was Paula. I mean, Paula was real tough. We were in the middle of summer, we're in her studio, no air conditioner, you know, she's got a stick over on the side, pounding that beat out on the floor, and, now I learned a lot those summers that I had doing ballet.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Well, I enjoyed ballet, but I wish I had done tap. Every time I see someone tap dance, I think to myself, I wish I'd done
tap. Is probably my least of all of them, just because I did ballet for so long. I tell people that tap's hard to do because I was so used to with ballet that my foot needed to be pointed straight that when I got into the tap classes, I couldn't loosen my foot up enough to have that flop thing to really be able to hit those, you know.
So
tap's not my favorite. Modern was okay, but I guess ballet jazz was probably my two favorites.
I couldn't do modern. I took one modern class, and I was more used to the you know, first, second, third, fourth, da da da, you know, and the easy calm music. And when the first class I took, the instructor kind of did a baboon thing, running down and doing like this with her hands. I was like, nah, it's just no way I can do that kind of crap. So I didn't go back. So,
but I got a chance with all the dance and ballet and jazz and stuff. It gave me a chance to do a lot of musical theater. So I grew up doing a lot of musical theater. I was never a great singer. I can carry a tune. I tell people I'm no great singer by any means, but I was able to at least carry a tune enough to do the character type roles that you would get for me in musical theater.
Well, you did a lot of. I noticed you'd done a lot of theater. Around Dallas-Fort Worth, and that's where your roots are, I guess.
My roots is theater. I guess I went to Mountain View Conservatory in 1997. I was kind of ready to go back to school and try to get my degree going because I wanted to finish it. And so 95 to 97, I'd gone to Mountain View. I graduated in 97, went from 97 to 2000. I toured nationally with Dallas Children's Theater, like I said before. I got back here in 2000, and I just wanted something different. I've been doing theater my entire life. I dabbled a little bit here and there with film stuff, but nothing major. And I got back here, I was in that crossroads of, do I want to keep acting, or am I ready to go into something else?
Because
I love the theater, but it was just ready for something else. And so I started doing some film work here and there, got an agent, I guess maybe the 2001 with Linda McAllister, and been with her ever since.
So what was your first jump into the film world that kept you on that path?
There was, I would have to say, there was a film that I did for the University of North Texas out in Denton.
Yeah.
It was called Wine and Beer.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a short. I can't remember. It's been so long now. Who the most of the actors that was in it had moved on. I know the directors moved on for other places now. But started doing that. Started doing a few little commercial things here and there. I mean, I don't feel like my career in film really took off till probably 04, 05.
Really? Because you've really done a lot of commercials, I noticed.
Yeah, it's weird because I tell people it's kind of, you know, this whole business, as you guys know, is just kind of a, you know, it's a flow. It's kind of, I was telling somebody the other day, I said, you know, you ride that wave for as long as you can, because for so many years I did commercials. I didn't hardly do film or TV. And then for the last few years, I've done nothing but it seems like a lot of film and TV type work. And then I haven't hardly done any commercials until about a week or two ago. I was able to do a Capital One commercial. So.
Yeah, cool. And right now you're working on... what did I write down? The Wrong Side of Heaven. What's that all about? That's it. Now that's a TV show, right?
This is a TV show. Yeah, this is a TV show. Rosa Nichols, a local actress, director, producer, writer from town, from around the Dallas-Fort Worth area. She's involved in it. Basically, it's a TV show that they're trying to get to put on faith-based type networks.
And it's gonna be on television, not like on YouTube or on.
No, internet. This is actually gonna be on television, but it's gonna be on like a faith-based type network.
All right, gotcha.
I want to say UAN, but I'm not exactly sure if that's correct or not. It's going to be. What the thing is right now is they want to see the first three episodes and see how it takes with the audience.
Right.
And if the first three episodes do well, then they want to go ahead and do a season, and then possibly maybe do six or seven seasons. We don't know.
And what are you doing there?
I play a guy by the name of Zachariah Hobson. I don't know, ex-Marine, kind of a former KKK guy. Got tattoos all over my body.
Right.
It's kind of in the sense, and I don't know how much I can talk about it because I know they're still trying to do it, but it's kind of in the sense of, you know, everybody wakes up one morning and people have just vanished and they don't know where they went. So kind of a rapture type thing.
Right.
And there's about four, five, six different storylines throughout the TV show of different people trying to get different places.
Right. Yeah. It's when you said tattoo, I remember now you had something on Facebook where you were looking for some place to get fake tattoos because you don't have it. And I assume you found those.
But actually, there's a lady on set named Shelley Pender that did my tattoos and they turned out really good.
Really?
So she's great.
Washed off.
And they washed right off. But I was lucky enough to be able to take them home and show my kids before I washed them off and freaked them out a little bit.
That's
so that's cool.
Right. And then I see somewhere else, let's see, you're there's also something else that you're currently All for Amy?
All for Amy is a...
That's a film.
That's a feature film I just finished up a few weeks ago. Local writer, director, putting together a feature film. He's put all of his money into the project. AJ Horst is the director. He's actually, you talk about guerrilla filmmaking here. It's like, it was him and it was his buddy, Jose, and it was the two of them, and they did everything.
Ours is more like chimpanzees.
The little bitty monkeys. It was just the two of them doing everything.
Yeah.
And you know, years ago when you're starting out and you're doing indie films and little student films, that doesn't, you know, really phase you or anything. You're just happy to be in. But then when you start seeing that after, you know, I've done this long enough now and I saw that and I'm like, how is this going to turn out? But I tell you what, I mean, it was like working, I don't know, whatever duo that's out there right now, Tarantino and Rodriguez, I guess, maybe. I mean, these guys were on the same page and knew what was going on. Sound, I mean, everything was just amazing.
And where are you in the life of that? Is it about right now?
I'm done. I think they got a few little they got a few scenes here and there that they're going to finish up by the end of August, but he's hoping by October and November to do a screening.
And then he's going to do a film festival circuit.
I don't know if he's going to do a film festival circuit. I mean, I know with the feature films, I'm not exactly sure what he plans on doing. I know we're going to do a screening, like I said, by the end of the year, and I'm not exactly sure what he wants to do with it after. I'm sure it's sort of festival
keep
things.
Keep us posted on that.
Yeah.
You brought us a reel to look at.
Yeah.
And so let's take a look at that, and we'll come back and talk a little bit about what we see on that. So we'll roll that right now.
Joe McCoy. I'm Mark Enderlin. This is Jody Russey. We're with Child Protective Services. We'd like to speak with you and your family. I couldn't find anyone to contact after his conviction, but when the mail came, I checked his phone bill.
A lot of guys have a little something on the side. Doesn't mean he didn't love you.
I'll get you a dog. A puppy.
I want a family.
Until we can turn this into a couple of hundred on a regular basis, they'll just have to wait. That's the plan. There, baby.
I'm demonstrating my commitment to you and the company by looking after your well-being.
Come on, Dave, drop your drawers. Need to check to see if you got any ruptures.
Well, howdy, Danny boy. Ever shot a real gun before? Think you can handle it? Ever had a real woman before? Ain't you lonely?
Well, yes. Yes, Buck Hanley. Yes to all three.
Danny, look.
Shut up!
You got a subdivision being built not a mile away from here, and ain't gonna stand for that shit, Derek. People hear a gunshot and they think they're the ones getting shot at. I just hope I don't have to make it my business.
Yeah, yeah, listen, I think I'm being watched. Yeah, someone's been in my house and they went through my garbage.
Yes, I'm sure raccoons don't open windows.
You seem to be having trouble remembering just how much you owe. You should try tying a piece of string around your finger to remember.
Sure.
You having the string?
Not with me.
We don't either.
You remember Lois, don't you?
She remembered you. She was in a lot of pain. Those pills couldn't help much last month. But she remembered you all right.
Daniel, no.
Right up to the end.
Danny!
I'm a realist, okay? I can see things how they really are. I mean, clearly you are the much better card player than me. So here's what we're gonna do. I'm going to take the odds out of the situation entirely. I mean, it's simple, really. All you got to do is draw a higher card than me.
So I gotta ask. What the deal was with Jeff? Anyway, in the forest with Jeff, you shot him.
Oh, Mark Jeffries.
Yeah, Mark. Yeah, Mark there Jeffries. We go. I knew there's a Jeff in there somewhere.
I had to think about it for a second. Yeah. That was a film called. Oh my gosh. That happened about, it was 6-7 years ago. It's been a while now. It's called Prescription. And it was basically my character. We shot it, the whole thing down in Waco. Yeah. And my character works at a pharmacy. His wife passed away. And he finds out that Mark Jeffries' character and her had hooked up right before she passed away. And so it's him trying to figure out how he wants to kill Mark Jeffries' character.
So That was an interesting scene. It kind of I like the whole.
That's a great scene because before that I'm in all the pharmaceutical type, you know, a little tie and all that, and kind of the nerdy guy. But then all of a sudden you see me out there shooting.
And I like the way you went from the. I mean, I guess that was part of the psychological side of it. Was you went from the a river movie where they're with a squeal like
Deliverance.
You kind of went from that Deliverance back to who you really were.
Yeah. Actually, that scene that's in the demo that was in the reel was that's a kind of a flashback scene. So basically, I go out to the woods. I've got my guns. I've never shot guns before, and I'm trying to shoot guns. Well, I happen to shoot. I think it was a deer, and so I go by the deer, and all of a sudden I kind of lay down and fall asleep, and then it's a flashback scene of okay, well, instead of it being a deer, now it was Mark Jeffrey's character is sitting there instead. So.
Is most of these movies, independence things, you've got to rent.
Most of the
and
stuff
are they
like
someplace
that.
Where people can see them? Or?
Go to my website, jefffenter.com.
And you have the
reel. Actually, I got a 3-minute reel and a one minute.
No, I mean
reel
the movies themselves. Is
there the movies. No, I don't have any place where I can. That was been so long.
Yeah.
Now that I got a bunch of commercials and stuff on the website, but not the movie stuff. So. Yeah.
Well, that was a very good demo. I enjoyed that because you did go a lot of different areas.
Yeah, David Pinkston did that. I don't know if you guys have worked with him or something, but David Pinkston had did that, and you know he's amazing on what he does. So I told him I wanted to do that, and that's probably been 3 or 4 years now. But I want to do a little comedy and a little drama and stuff. So he put a little of everything in there. I liked it.
And I just happened to see that you were on Bailout. How was that?
It was cool. I kind of got called in at the last minute by Dennis. I don't know Dennis well, but I mean, we know each other and kind of passing and stuff. Yeah. And he called me out of the blue like a day or two before the shoot and said, hey, would you be interested? And I said, yeah, sure. So I got a chance to work with him and Marshall Teague and Terry Kaiser.
Yeah.
So it was cool.
You were in 2 or 3 episodes, weren't you, before he finally came to – well, because you're in the New York sequence, basically.
Yeah.
And then he comes to Texas and then
– And he had said at some point it may be a reoccurring role. They just don't know
yet. But your character got indicted for bribery or something.
I think something, I've never seen the whole episode, so I'm not really sure.
Yeah, maybe
I'm really bad about, you know, going back and watching this stuff because I'm just one of those type of actors that once I'm done with it, I'm ready to move on to something else.
Sure,
I'm not real big on looking at myself. So,
well, interesting. Yeah, I was watching because Dennis was going to be on the show, and I wanted to make sure I knew what was going on with him. So I watched most of those episodes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and you popped up, and I thought you did a great job. So
he's a good guy.
So coming from a theater background, I guess that's probably part of the reason why. But you're a big guy at STAGE. STAGE is what does STAGE stand for? It's an acronym for
STAGE stands for Society for Theatrical Artists Guidance and Enhancement.
Right.
So basically, what STAGE is, it's like an actor's resource center.
Right.
We give out audition information to our members. I'm the operations manager there. Been there since the STAGE itself's been around since 1981. I started working there in the summer of 2000 after I got back from touring. And P.L. Moore and Leslie Evans Leach actually created STAGE back in 1981. Started out of their own homes. Once a month, they would send out a newsletter in the old days.
I used to get that.
Email and internet and stuff. Yeah. And then, you know, just here, I guess the last, 8, 9, 10 years or so, we got rid of the newsletter, and now we're just doing weekly emails to our members. We do a class email, and we also do an audition email.
Right. And you have classes and
Yeah, we got John Davies, who's also a local actor that does a lot of stuff, teaches through us. Gail Kronauer, who does a lot of stuff.
Sure, I took one of her classes.
Gene Everton is still with us. Bob Michaels does our voiceover classes. Beth Bontley does a lot of our beginning acting type classes. So we got beginning acting, film acting, improv, auditioning for TV commercials.
And for everybody. I mean, you have for kids all the way through adult for classes. And
you got 3 or 4 different types of memberships. You can be, I tell people when they call, am I too old for this? I'm like, if you can read, you pretty much can do it. Even if you can't, I mean, you know, age-wise, because I've had people at 80, 85, 70 call me and say, hey, am I too old for this? I'm like, no, come down, take a class. I said, you may end up impressing somebody and take off, so you never know.
All right, cool. Yeah, I used to get the newsletter that they sent out years ago.
Oh yeah,
yeah, because it had theater production or theater auditions, and I guess some. Because back in those days, I guess there wasn't a whole. I don't know. It seemed like there was more theater than there was film back in the early 90s.
I think it's completely changed now. Yeah, I'm sure. Or it feels like it has, because, yeah. I mean, I didn't know hardly anything about film and stuff when I was growing up in the 90s doing a lot of theater. I mean, I heard film here and there, but it seems like... Now, we still get a lot of stuff of stage theater type stuff through stage.
Right.
But most of the people, it seems, that comes with us want to get into the film right. acting type business, commercial. That's the reason we have the auditioning for TV commercials with Gene Everton.
Right.
And we're over in Dallas, over off 35 in Inwood. So.
Right. And you have, if you're a member of Stage, and you are a producer, you can use the facility for casting and for rehearsals.
Yeah, we have what we call an industry membership, and it's usually $150 a year for the industry membership, and that comes with different perks once you get that. Anybody that's casting anything can send us stuff for free, and we'll send that out.
Oh, okay.
You don't have to be a member to have stuff sent out right. for our casting. And again, classes, we've got classes that range anywhere from $30 to $50 for a one-day workshop all the way up to $300 for a six-week class, depending right. on what you want to
and
take.
Do you teach anything over there?
Actually, I just got through teaching the two-week youth summer program from 11 to, it was 11 to 3 the past 2 weeks.
I know you do like scene coaching. If someone's got an audition coming up, you'll...
Yeah, I do a lot of... now that everything's pretty much gone to tapings and stuff and virtual castings and all that, it's,
right. yeah.
you know, you don't go in like you used to, or you can. I mean, I like the virtual casting if something over in Louisiana or New Mexico wants to see me, but I don't right. want to fly back and forth, or you don't have the money to fly back and forth or drive.
Sure.
So I started doing that a few years ago, and I am no computer guru by any means, so...
I think there's only two or three of those left in the world, because none of us are either, so...
But I started doing that a few years ago, kind of on my own, and I would get some people every once in a while to come down and help read with me just to have a reader.
Right.
And kind of figured it out on how to download it and stuff, and then the kind of word kind of got around that I do videotapings, and now people pretty
yeah,
much call me for videotapings. Yeah. And when people come in for videotaping, sometimes they want me to coach. So.
Right.
Yeah.
But if I had an audition coming up and I was going to go to Austin for it, I could call you up and I could say, hey, Jeff, I need help on the scene.
Yeah, if you wanted to come over for some coaching or something, and a lot of times people will come over for just coaching, or they'll come over for maybe 30-minute coaching, and then
right.
we'll spend the next 20 minutes on taping it. So actually, I think I got a couple to do
right.
here just in the next few days.
I see. So you said you started Stage after you were touring?
I started Stage after I was touring. I toured nationally with Dallas Children's Theater
from
97.
Oh, okay, all right.
Yeah, from 97 to 2000. I wish. I want to get into golf. I haven't done that yet.
Yeah.
So I started doing kids shows, and I tell people the coolest thing about the touring was that, you have, of course, you got to live out of the suitcase and
yeah,
go
right.
to different cities and stuff, but. I didn't do a lot of traveling when I was growing up as a kid, so I don't know if I've had been to three states by the time 97 had rolled around.
Yeah.
Besides, maybe Kansas, the northern states just surrounding Texas, and from the 3 years that I toured, by the time we finished, I think there's maybe three, four states I haven't been to yet.
Wow!
So.
It's really
cool.
Children's Theater gets around.
Yeah. You got a chance to go all
how
across
long
the country.
Tour, how long is it for?
The tour started, I think we opened here in August and did a few runs at Eastfield College over in Mesquite. And then I'm not sure where they're doing it now because it's been so long. But then after that, we hit the road till about Thanksgiving. Sometimes we went through Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
Sometimes we would come back around Christmas time. Usually you wouldn't go out more than maybe a month and a half, 2 months. You would roll back through here for maybe a week, and then go back out.
And what would you do, like one or two night runs and then move on to the next town? Or?
Most of the time, no. And we were the actors, we had we had our tech guy. We had basically our stage manager / company manager guy. And then the rest of us were anywhere from 6 actors to 10 actors. We were in a 15-passenger van, one of those long, big white vans
wow.
that you see. We had a 24-foot truck that the whole set was shoved into and
holy cow.
Took off. And I tell people it was the coolest experience I've ever had. I mean, I got a chance, to... then all the people that you had to deal with for 3 years just right. on the road, and you got a chance to really chill out with some of those, you know, learn to chill with some of the people right. that you worked with. So
that's what the touring was. So, and you said earlier, I just wanted to know, you said you had aspirations of playing baseball. Were you into sports? You did baseball?
Yeah, I was into sports big time. I played soccer. I was horrible at soccer. I can't tell you how many times I almost
everybody did. Everybody from this country is horrible at soccer. Oh, soccer was not an American sport.
Not at all. Every time I headed the ball, I would almost pee my pants because I knew it was going in my goal the wrong way. And I just heard my dad on the side like, "No!" It was like slow motion. But I was pretty decent at baseball. Played catcher. I mean, I wasn't great, but I figured if I would have stuck with it, any sport I'd have stuck with, it would have been probably baseball. So,
yeah.
My bad habit was not knowing when not to throw to second base.
Right.
Anytime I saw anybody stealing, whether somebody was on third or not, I wanted to throw to second base to show you I could get that person out.
No, he's going home. I play catcher too, and I just played a little bit with Little League, but I could barely get it to third, second base anyway. So.
Oh, I had dribbled there a lot.
Yeah.
I dribbled.
Yeah, a lot of times the pitcher caught the ball in between, so I didn't make any difference. And I was trying to throw it over you. Oh, sorry.
Help me.
Yeah. But, I ran track. I played football, too. But I was really killer at Sandlot, you know, just with pads and all that kind of stuff. You put a pair of shoulder pads on me and some hip pads, and I couldn't even run.
I wanted to play football, but mommy wouldn't let me back in elementary. And by the time that I, you know, she would have let me, it was like in the middle school, first to high school. And by that time, I just felt like I was probably way past the football stage, and I was in the theater itself. So.
Right. Yeah. I didn't play in high school, but I was a track player. So. What's next?
The Wrong Side of Heaven. Got some auditions coming up, and. That's pretty much it. I mean, I don't have anything major coming up right now. Just auditions.
I saw that you, The Box, you wrote and produced. And
yeah, my wife and I, my wife's an up-and-coming writer, so she's really been wanting to get into the writing side. And
right.
I feel like I have all these good ideas, but I can't sit still long enough to do the writing thing is my problem. I feel like I got a few good ideas, so I try to throw them over to her, but... The Box that her and I co-wrote, and she actually wrote it. I helped her write it into a screenplay, and then we both produced it. But The Box was something that she had written, and I turned around and put it into a screenplay, and we had Hugo Martinez was our director. It's a guy that I've worked with a few times on a few projects. Mm-hmm. And we've actually had a pretty decent success on the festival circuit. I mean, we haven't won any major awards.
Well, you won a couple of awards for that.
Won a few little awards here and there along the way.
Nominated
It's 2 or 3 minutes long. I've been nominated. The film itself's been nominated.
Right.
So, we just got through. I know playing at the Fort Worth Independent Film Festival, but I didn't get a chance to make it out there. Yeah. But my director was telling me about it. He got a chance to go. And
So I guess unless she gets behind you and gives you the prodding, there's not a whole lot of writing a script and producing your own material and coming out.
Yeah, you know what? I try to a couple of times a year to sit down or think about it. I've got ideas. It's just I'm not that smart.
Right.
You know the big words and all that stuff. I just tell people, you know, I mean, I play an actor. I look smart on TV, but I don't.
I'm the same way. I try to write a script, and I look up script writing things, and they're always talking about arcs and stuff like that. I'm going, I don't understand what an arc is. My guy goes in, he kills the other guy, then runs away with a girl, and then they all wind up in Mexico, and that's all I know.
Yeah, and then you have hard to have these 6 or 7 different storylines. Whoa, wait a minute, you know? You got all these different storylines that are supposed to come out of it. Yeah. This one was pretty simple. We filmed it it was just a weekend. And I like doing those. If I'm going to do stuff like this that I don't have time to write a full script or even, you know, my wife's been busy too with her stuff. So it gives you a chance to do something but kind of move on because it's only, as you guys know, it's only like a one or two, you know, on the weekend, one or two weekends at the most, and you move on. So there's so many stuff going on in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. It's great. It's really starting to come up here. I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on. A lot of the colleges around here, you know, the indie projects from the colleges, student projects. So there's always something you can get into.
Right. There's always something. And a lot of the Hollywood mainstream stuff, you know, the incentives and everything, they're coming out here to TV shows at least.
Uh-huh.
I saw that you'd done Prison Break. And
did Prison Break. I got a chance to do Breaking Bad, a couple of years ago. I got a chance to actually, my scene was with Bryan Cranston. Right. So, cool. And I tell people, you want to talk about one of those actors that's just very gracious and so nice. I mean, he deserves everything he's getting. Really, I mean, good. He deserves everything he's getting. He's a really cool guy. I had one day on set, I joke with people because I was the urinal guy. That was my character's name.
Oh, really?
The urinal guy. And so they fly me all the way over to New Mexico to shoot the scene. Actually, I walk up to my trailer and they've already put in orange tape the urinal guy. Though the crew and the set people just love it.
That's funny.
And I get on set. I haven't seen Brian at all. I wasn't even sure if my scene was at the time was going to be with Brian until right because I don't think I even had a script yet. So, so I realized my scene was going to be with Brian and. We're on break or something while we're on set. And I walk down at the end of the hallway. I'm not one of those ones that's want to go, hey, man, how's it going, Brian? Hey, how's it going here? You know, so I go down in the hallway and just kind of sitting there. And a few minutes later, here comes Mr. Cranston walking all the way down the hallway, sits next to me and just starts chit-chatting.
Really? Cool.
And we must have sat there for about 10 or 15 minutes. And before I could even finish, hey, could I get a photo? He was like, hey, hold on just a minute, and hollered at somebody over on set. Say, hey, can you come here and get a picture of me and my new buddy Jeff?
Wow, cool.
So he was a really cool guy.
That's cool.
Sam.
All right. Well, I appreciate you taking the time to make your way out here.
No problem. Thanks for having me. This is great.
I bet some viewers are going to want to join Stage. Do you give the? Could you give us the website?
Yeah, it's www.stage, S-T-A-G-E, hyphen, online.org, O-R-G.
Stageonline.org.
Hyphen.
With a hyphen in between
hyphen.
Stage and online.
Yes, sir.
You got that?
I'm amazed that I remember the demo. The last two people we've had on here, John, at the end of the thing, going, didn't we want to watch the demo? I was, oh, yeah.
If you're starting out in acting, I was a member of Stage when I was more serious about acting, and that certainly is a great place to start out, especially if you're in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. That's,
I was a member. I took Gail's class, and...
Yeah, so did I.
Did you?
She was great at telling me all the things I was doing wrong, you know. But she couldn't come up with a way of correcting them. And that's where I stand. But for everyone else, she was
great.
Yeah, she's a really good teacher. Yeah. Gail Cronow, I really recommend her class.
Yeah.
And Gene Everton's commercial class
auditioning
is fantastic.
Commercials, yeah.
Yeah,
she's
that's
great.
A great one.
Yeah, they've been around for a long time, and they know what they're talking about, so take it. Good
and,
classes.
Bob Michael's voiceover, I took his. I don't know why he does that class, because he seems to be so successful on his own.
Oh, I know.
I'm not sure why he bothers to teach, but he does, and he is very generous with advice.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's a great
one of the nicest guys you'll ever meet.
Involved in voiceover. Terrific class.
Yeah.
And I've always wanted to see what John Davies' class was like, because I've heard great things about that, but haven't.
I've known John for a long time. I'm glad we got him over at Two Stage, because we met back in when I was in Mountain View from 95 to 97 as just a film teacher, acting teacher at one point.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, me?
No. Hey. Do you have anything to say about Stage, then?
Nah, you got it all. I think you did a fine job. All right, man. Listen, thanks for coming.
Thanks for having me.
And we appreciate your time and hard work. And
well, much success. This is very cool. I'm glad you guys are doing this.
Well, thanks. Yeah. We're going to take a little break. John's leaving, going back to New Jersey for a month, and I'm gonna go out and buy a couple of 30 packs and
shoot some fireworks and ready to go.
I'm just going to walk down into the woods and sit under a tree for the next 3 or 4 weeks. But,
and hibernate.
Yeah, and hibernate. But we'll be back in the fall. And
cool.
And maybe we'll get you back on after.
Right.
So, yeah, because I'm interested in I messed up now. Wrong Side of Heaven.
Cool.
And where
I'd love
that's
to come
gonna
back.
Be, so.
Yeah.
Anyway, all right. Well, listen, we appreciate you. This is the last show. Oh, wait, whoa, ho, you didn't.
Come on.
You didn't. See, finally, I have to remind myself of something. I've learned over the last couple of weeks how invaluable a co-host is on many, many occasions. Well, aren't we going to look at that reel? Weren't you going to do this? I'm looking forward to doing this. Oh, yeah. We're going to give away this fine, beautiful... The Dean Show Cup. It's decorated with an Emmy. No, with an Oscar, which I know is movies, but anyway, Julie picked that up, so we put it on there. And anyway, so we had it, the thing was that if you shared one of the posts on Facebook, that we took your name and stuck it in here, and there's a few, so we're gonna let the great and talented Jeff Fenter do the drawing.
All right, let's pick a winner.
Yeah. My goodness. Yeah.
Nice.
Nobody, you guys know, but I think I went to high school with him.
Sweet. Oh,
yeah.
I was like,
what? Yeah. He's.
Do I know him?
he's helped us out, and I think he's still in Lubbock, Texas. So, Mike, yeah, if you watch this and see that we've drawn your name, and then you email me and say, "Hey, I saw this. You drew my name. We'll send you the cup." So, but you got to watch the show to get it. No, I'm just kidding. We'll contact you. So, anyway. But anyway, thanks for coming, and thanks for watching our first. I don't know if it's a season really, but our first
pilot season.
Yeah. All hopefully, right. We're gonna come back with some bigger and better things like we talked about. Like the downtown Fort Worth cityscape as opposed to the downtown. See, what we tell them is this was going to be the 7th Street Bridge originally, but they changed it to what it is today. So that really is downtown Fort Worth. There's just an artist.
Yeah, my wife had made a comment when we were watching the other episode. She's like, "That's not Dallas." I'll ask him that when I get up.
Yeah, that's New York. It kind of arrived on the set before we kind of got started. So. Anyway, but we're going to try to do some things like that. So, anyway. All right, listen. Got to get out of here. Thanks for coming. Take care. Bye-bye.